Hey guys, welcome back.
Hi, Thana, how are you?
Good. Okay. So I keep losing track. I'm not sure what episode this is, the number, but I think let's not count the number of episodes, but count the good content that we are delivering here. As you know, we have Mike Yap and myself. I'm a guest for this week, and we're going to give you some knowledge, know-how into transverse and longitudinal engines, and we've got a special guest for this week. So before we get started, Mike, how are you, Mike, this week?
I'm good. Yeah, struggling a bit with my exercise this week. Yeah, because of the lockdown, I haven't been able to go and do it.
You struggled this morning.
You're
putting me to shame, Mike. I think the amount of workout that you do compared to what I do.
Don't know, energy down, you know, once I don't do my exercise.
Yeah, same here. I feel right now I have no energy to work out, but I know I do work out, but I don't work out. So we're going to give a couple of minutes before everybody joins in, and then we'll have a forum to start the day. But before that, let's introduce our guest for today. Today we've got Korn in the house, Korn from Horizon. Say hi to Korn.
Hi, guys. Korn, how are you? Korn.
We have a special guest. Oh!
What?
It's a WRX.
Yeah,
toy car.
Yeah, WRX.
And I like this one because it has the dirt, the mud effect, you know, it's pretty cool.
Mud
effect.
Yeah, very nice.
Yeah.
So so today we're going to talk about transverse and longitudinal engines. To some, it might be a heavy topic, but actually it isn't a heavy topic. It's about, I guess, knowing what the cars are. And back then compared to now, I believe the differential has been slowly cutting away, you know, but even then, I think all consumers should know what they are. I think it's a topic. Korn, as you know, is an engineer by experience and university and knowledge.
Not quite a practicing one, lah.
Yeah, but you put the knowledge into practice. I mean, if you see Korn's videos on DIYs and Korn's video on things like exporting things, Korn does go to a bit more nerdy aspect of it on how things work and why this and that. So we thought you'll be the perfect person to be on board to talk about this topic over here. So Korn, thank you again for joining us. How's your jab?
Hey, thanks for having
your second jab yesterday.
I in fact, when you guys invited me on board, I say, hey, fair warning, I just had my AZ shot yesterday. So if I come online, come live looking like shit, please don't blame me.
But I don't know about this. I'm a bit confused about this whole reaction thing, because from what I've seen is the people who took the jab on that first batch when earlier, all of them had symptoms.
Yeah.
Some of the people are taking the jab now have less symptoms. So I'm not sure why.
Maybe the first jab was the one that really primed your defense system pretty. This is just like, you know, a reinforcement.
So, but even people who are taking the first jab now, they're having lesser impact. I mean, I don't know. And also, I think
If I remember correctly, you had your first jab before mine, right? So you should have had your second jab by now, really.
Yeah, I got my second jab last week or 2 weeks ago. I had my second jab, and it was a little bit of like feverish thing, but it was nothing like the first jab. First jab was
quite severe. One of our colleagues had her first jab. 3 days she was gone out, but second jab she didn't feel anything.
And the funny thing is that all vaccines could have a reaction. Diana, which we had on board on my show, the first one, she had Pfizer, and she had severe reaction. She was like MC for 3 days.
My missus took her first jab Pfizer a few days back, didn't feel anything. My parents both took Sinovac, also didn't have any side effects.
Yeah,
it was me and my sister-in-law after our first AZ jab, the two of us that turned out quite bad.
And I noticed that Sinovac has got lesser impact.
I think
the whole issue of some countries not allowing, some not having the vaccines because of side effects, not so much the effectiveness, but more the side effects, you know?
Yeah.
Yes.
But anyway,
I think this exact one is a bit more, you know, the effect, because my colleague also went sick on the second day. You know, I think She was vomiting.
But I think no choice lah. We all of us, we need to have jab. Otherwise, we can't get our lives back. It's as simple as that.
Yeah. And even a jab doesn't mean you are protected. Close friend of mine, a very close friend of mine, just came positive from COVID. He went to his factory and he got infected. He had his second jab, and after 1 week, he got infected. Now he has no taste, no smell. He can't, fever, high fever, and it's after second jab. So even with the jab, is this? So imagine without the jab, how bad
it would be. I think what people need to understand is that the jab is not a shield, right? I always like to use this metaphor. You see, the jab, right, is like a gun for you to defend your house. It doesn't stop the robber from coming in and ransacking you, but it gives you a chance to shoot the fella, you know. So you may miss, you may not, but you have a chance to shoot the fella. That's all.
Yeah, yeah. Correct. Ammunition.
You've got a bit of a defense, lah, you know.
Yeah, yeah. We have reached a stage where that is our only way out, really, because it is impossible to suppress COVID anymore, right? And we can't be in lockdown and in limbo forever, right? We have to. Yeah. We all of us need to go out. I've got cars to review. You guys got cars to tune.
Yep.
Right.
So definitely.
Yeah, life has to go on.
I'm missing that driving, man.
Tell me about it.
2 months already. 2 months already. I
don't know how much of a percentage the COVID will have on the people becoming worse drivers than before, because they don't have enough time on the wheel. So anyway, we're going to kick off. It's 4 o'clock exactly on the dot. We'll start our intro, and we come back, we'll start today's topic.
Yeah.
Welcome back. That's our cheerful go from
nice, short and sweet intro.
Yes.
So anyway, Korn, transverse versus longitudinal engine.
Yeah.
And I guess the first thing I suffered when I was much younger was trying to memorize which is which. I mean, we get the logic one this way, one that way. I've got my own way of trying to remember which is which. How do you suggest people who are really young and new or trying to understand that, how do you remember which is which?
Actually, I think you mean where transverse versus... Actually, I think it's best, right, to start off with, you don't bother knowing what's transverse, what's longitudinal. You just know which one is north-south, which one is east-west.
Wow, so complicating.
I mean, which one is basically which one is
compass?
I
asked the wrong question. Right?
So yeah, I understand. I mean, you're looking from a longitudinal point of view versus
vertical and horizontal.
I remember it very simple. What is the longest way? What is the longest part of the car?
Yes,
longitudinal.
So
guys, if you don't understand, if you get have a car, the car is this way, the engine can be this way or this way. This way means it's longitudinal, it means it's long, and this way is transverse because it's just the money line. No? For a car.
So I got a BMW 7 Series.
You had to ride.
BMW. This is exactly longitudinal engine.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. So, if you look at the undercarriage side, this is how the engine here sends the drive back to the rear view. So, longitudinal engine, it has to be aligned this way primarily for rear view drive cars, so that you can align the engine with the drive shaft to send power back to the rear axle.
So we're gonna start with a small intro. The guys who are here now. So we've got Zafri Zainal. Hey, hi Mike Thana. Hi Zafri. We got Kanishan in the house. Thank you.
Hi Kanishan.
We got Kanishan saying you need 2 weeks after second
jab. I see you often on on Top Gear.
Top Gear.
I see you often on Top Gear.
All our fans.
Yep, Top Gear, Top Gear. Yeah.
And then we've got, hi, hee hee, you've got this. Okay. And then engineer speaking. True, engineer speaking.
Okay. I don't know.
going back to your comment about north south, what is that? So that's like, because of the map, the way it's.
Yeah. North south. North south will be longitudinal, okay? Because we always, when we read our map, right, we always sort of like perceive north is like this way, whereas our east west is across us.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So again, we've got Ridzwan here.
Ridzwan.
Yeah. So we're going to just show a video here, a short clip from Car Portal. I think it's a good video, how to get our head around this. And while we're doing this, we'll stop and we'll probably just explain as we go along. Okay. So give me a second while I cue this in.
Transverse engines are mounted perpendicularly to the direction of travel, lying horizontally in the engine bay. This setup is predominantly used in front-engine, front-wheel drive vehicles where the transmission is fixed to the side of the engine block along with an off-center differential for a simple insertion of the drive shafts through CV joints.
That's a lot of information there, isn't it? So you want us to break that down for us, Con?
Wow. basically, right, you see, for transverse engine is conceived for the purpose of, well, primarily for front wheel drive cars, but if I get my facts correct, certain cars like the Porsche Boxster also use transverse engine, but they are transverse mid-mounted engine.
The Arteon,
of course, is transverse because it's platform, Passat, Golf, and all that. When you are transverse, the idea of using a transverse engine is so that you have your engine, your transmission, and you can mount this in line with the axle which you are driving. Right?
So it's almost like a one-piece thing. It's like everything is in the same place. So it's in the same place. You got less things to worry about. It's just one piece, a power plant, just pop it in.
So the thing is that with transverse engines, you are putting let's say that this is the width of your car, right? You have your engine on one side, transmission on the other, or it could be the other way around, it depends on the car manufacturer. Mm. So it's all fitted into this space within the width of the car. All right. And from there, your drive shaft will come out from the transmission to one wheel each. Now the problem with this setup is that you have, because your engine is offset to one side, your gearbox is offset to the other side.
Yeah.
And your left and right drive shafts are both will be on unequal length.
Yeah.
So if you are talking about a 100, 120 horsepower car, that is fine. But when you go high performance, right, that introduces a phenomenon called torque steer, because the same amount of torque going into drive shafts of unequal length, which means that by the time the torque reaches the wheel, the left and right wheel are actually getting different amounts of torque.
Yes. Yes.
So they are both accelerated at slightly different rates, and that's why you're saying,
I think there are certain cases by that made spaces to kind of offset those. And there are some very few cases.
Yeah.
But I think
bearings in the middle. Yeah. Also, you know, if you notice your drive shaft, your left and right drive shaft, usually the diameter is different.
Correct. Yes. I think that's one way to compensate. But when you can compensate, right? It's easy to compensate when you are about 100 plus horses, or maybe below 200 horses. But when you're a Mazda 3 MPS, you're shunting easily 300-400 newton meters of torque.
Correct.
The compensation gets very tricky, you know.
Yes. That's why the MPS is famous for torque steer.
Yes. That's a much loved car, but one of my old peers from the motoring media industry once said that car is an accident in the making.
True. Yes. I think many got written off, right? Those MPS.
Can you highlight the comment by Iskandar Jamaluddin? Yeah, Subaru is transverse, right? Just the Boxer is a lay. Mm. No, Subaru is longitudinal.
Yeah.
Subaru is actually quite unique because where's my Subaru just now? My
Actually, even the Porsche is even the Porsche goes this way, isn't it?
The
Porsche Boxster.
Yes.
The Boxster, the Caymans, the mid engine car. So all the mid engine Boxster Cayman goes longitudinal. And because all the Boxer engines, when they're not in the, I'm not sure about the 911s, but it's just this way. And that's how you access the plugs on the sides. And the timing belts are basically behind the back seat.
Actually, you brought up something, Con. You know, just makes me remember, there's actually one mid-engine car, which is Transverse, And it was actually the Lamborghini Miura. Lamborghini Miura, that was Transverse mid-engine.
But I think the Toyota MR2 and MRS probably would have been Transverse, right?
Yes.
Because
the plugs are this way.
Yes.
Because it would make sense for them so that they can recycle the whole Corolla engine and drivetrain, just transfer it to the back of the car, right?
Even when MGF is, if I'm not mistaken, it's transverse.
Your MGF is basically using an old Honda engine. Right?
Honda engine, correct. So, I think the essential thing is that transverse engine has the limitation of when you go to a big engine, that's where the problem starts. Yeah. Because a big engine
That's why that's why transverse engines, right? Most of them are four cylinders. They want to add cylinders, they go V6.
Yeah.
But there was one manufacturer that was crazy enough to stuff a straight six into a transverse installation.
Oh, who?
Yeah, Volvo.
Volvo.
Yes.
Oh.
The previous gen, cars, like the fourth generation cars, right? They had, when you see like the T6, was actually a 3-liter inline six mounted transverse. You know how they package that? I also scratch head, man.
Yeah, because when you open the bonnet, right, the whole engine almost took up the entire.
And you know what's best? The S80, the S80 and the XC90 even had a transverse V8.
I guess the trick is more on the gearbox, the transmission. The engine is the problem, but how do you manage the gearbox and transmission to go around?
And do you know that Volvo made a deliberate decision to not use longitudinal engines anymore for a safe? It's for a safety reason.
I see.
Yeah. So you see, because Volvo's reasoning was that if you have a longitudinal engine, in the event of a crash, that engine has the risk of punching straight through the firewall. Whereas in a transverse engine, the forces are in a way the engine also acts somewhat like a block, in between to dissipate the collision forces.
But then all the collision, before the firewall, basically.
Because if you remember back then, the Volvos like the 240s. The 740s, the 940s were all longitudinal engine rear wheel drive cars.
Yeah.
Then it was the 850 where they introduced the transverse engine. That was the time when Volvo decided that, to meet their requirements of safety, they are going all out for transverse engine mounting. Mm. That's why like right now, all their cars are still transverse engine mounted.
Yeah. I mean, if you have seen excellent pictures, you can see this engine upon impact. It'll be under the car. It will just go and car will be on top.
Yes. So the comment from Toyota, I can't remember the exact engine code, but it was a Yamaha developed V8. Yes, it was a Yamaha developed V8.
People forget Yamaha
makes a good engineering house.
Good engine company. Yeah.
Going back to Iskandar's question, right? Subaru is a very unique way of doing it. In fact, Subaru, for one, what I heard is that Subaru manufactures their own gearboxes. Why? Because there is no off-the-shelf gearbox that can fit Subaru's unique drivetrain arrangement. As far as I know. This is someone in Subaru told me. So Subaru, and that's why you see Subaru cars, right? They have very long front overhangs because the whole boxer engine sits in front of the front axle. Then, right, then it drives the gearbox, and then from the gearbox, it splits to the front wheels, one more shaft back, and drive the rear wheels.
I guess it depends if you're, I mean, boxer engines now, again, to answer this question, boxer refers to the engine type, not the way the engine is.
Not the installation.
Maybe you can clarify again, it's just two things, right?
Yeah.
Boxer is like the inline six, you got a V6, you got V12. So boxer is just the fact the engine is, instead of being this way, this way, it's flat. So when they're flat, I guess the question is how you mount them. Now, I know for a fact that the Porsche are longitudinal. Boxer, I think they do make transverse engine, I think.
So, to be accurate about it, right, when we say transverse or longitudinal, we have to it has it. The final determining factor is the alignment of the crankshaft.
Oh, I mean, crankshaft, where the pistons are, the piston rolls are located.
Because boxer is like that, ma. Your crankshaft is this direction. Your pistons are moving in this direction.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah.
So I would say, like, for me, it's like the banks, like bank one and bank two. If the banks are this way for your car, then it's longitudinal.
That makes sense too. Yes.
That's how I would see it.
Yeah. Yes.
Unless they make a boxer engine to bullet like that, to nobody is stupid. No one will do that. Maybe the other plane will do that.
But the thing is, somebody once told me, that time when I checked out the latest gen Forester, right? You know, Subaru made the bonnet open 90 degrees because majority of valve train work or whatever, right? You will need to lift the engine up.
Yeah, I mean, you can't get to the back.
The boxer engine is wide, man.
Yeah,
it sits in there, so you have to lift the engine up in order to access the valve train.
Yeah, you can't go to the back, which is troublesome. Right. Like I'll give you an example, like the Kia Carnival, which I had. The Kia Carnival is a V6, but transverse.
So it was
stupidly difficult to work on. Like I do my own work, like changing oil plugs. I'll do that, you know. But to get to the coil plug,
and that one is always the fun one.
We had to take out the whole intake manifold out to get to the plugs.
All right. Actually, a lot of owners learn this lesson from another car, the Padana.
Padana's also
Padana V6. The front three spark plugs, very easy to access. It's the back three. The back three that's facing the firewall. So
which almost makes you think like the transverse big engines are basically an afterthought. It's like they need more power into your platform. And they're like,
actually, if you're a transverse engine, the best is four cylinders.
Yeah. Okay. So we're gonna finish the video and then we'll come back shortly.
Transverse engines have become the norm in smaller mass production cars, with a V6 usually being the largest layout that can be mounted in this way. Although transverse V8 powered cars do exist, including the North Star engined Cadillac DeVille. The main reason for the transverse engine's popularity is because it frees up space elsewhere in the chassis. In city cars, a transverse engine allows for more room in the interior, and the lack of a central tunnel needed for the transmission and prop shaft means that the floor can be flatter to maximize passenger comfort and space. Cars with transverse engines also tend to be lighter, which is good for fuel economy and ease of driving. In terms of driving dynamics, a front-mounted transverse engine places the majority of the car's weight over the front wheels. In a front-wheel drive car, this gives maximum traction to the driven wheels, which is good for acceleration and for tackling slippery surfaces. The lack of drivetrain components needed also means the overall weight and manufacturing costs are reduced, generally making these cars less expensive to buy. Unfortunately, transverse engine layouts do have their limitations. Torque steer in cars with big power is their greatest enemy, as this is induced by the difference in drive shaft length that produce differences in torsional stiffness. This problem has been negated by engineers through various ways. Transverse engines are also restricted in terms of their displacement and potential power output because of the limited horizontal space in a front-wheel drive front-engine car. And we also can't ignore the fact that front-engine front-wheel drive cars can't throttle through corners quite like this.
I hate the fact whenever we talk about cars, there's always a BMW in the picture. And you're like, you know what? End of the day, it can't be a BMW.
Front engine rear wheel drive.
I think an important point there was in terms of cabin space, and I think people forget about cabin space. Yes. I guess let's compare the Passat and let's say compare the BMW, you know, and cabin space I think speaks volume. I think
quality. Let's compare the X1, the previous X1. Gen and the current gen.
Okay, very good.
Mike, can you show the comparison picture that I sent you guys earlier? So as you all know, right, BMW interior space isn't exactly the great. The first gen X1 is based on the E90 chassis, not known to be a very spacious car. Then when I first tested the second gen X1, right? When I first tested the second gen X1, which is the white car, the first thing that caught me was, wow, I have never seen a BMW interior which is as practical as this. Leh.
Yep.
You know, it's like, you know, BMW in the interior designers, right? They always had to work with the constraints of rear wheel drive. Suddenly, when they are free of that constraint, right, they're like, wow, there's so much space I can use here, and all that. Mm. So yes. This Gen X1, I feel, has a very, very practical interior. I mean, of course, it's not as nice as the first gen to drive, but as a family car, the second gen one is a much better family car. And you notice how the engine placement affects the proportions of the car. You look at the area where I circle, right? It's very easy. One that you see that small gap, if you see that small distance between the front door hinge and the wheel, or rather it's the distance between the firewall and the front axle. Transverse engine cars usually have it very short. Whereas if it's a longitudinal engine, that length between the front door and the front wheel is much longer.
Yeah. So I guess this works both ways, you know, because one is from the point of view of weight distribution.
Right.
From the point of view of cabin space. So if you think about it, guys, now if you think about the engine where it sits, the moment it goes this way, it has to eat into the cabin space a bit. So that's a cabin.
And the other thing, this is my speculation. Theophilus got it. Dash axle. Thanks for highlighting it. The other thing that is my speculation, it's the steering gear. So the thing is that why you want to push the wheels front forward is because you want to accommodate the long engine. But once you rotate your engine transversely, you don't have to push it so far forward anymore. Ma. You can shorten that distance between your dash and the axle. That way, your steering gear becomes less complicated.
The only flip side is like they talk about let's say a A3 and a, let's say A4, for example, you know?
Correct.
For example, A6, you know? When it's a transverse engine, the car has a shorter nose. Like. So on an SE platform, it looks okay, a short nose. But the moment it's like a sedan, you want that long nose to be there, like a BMW. BMW cars have got that whole majestic look to it, even from then till now, is because they were longer, and that is what makes it look good.
They push the front wheels further forward as well because they want to try to contain as much of the engine weight behind the rear axle, behind the front axle, to give the car better balance. In fact, if you have seen the engine bay of the F33 series, right, the 318, the 1.5 three-cylinder, which everybody likes to put up, the entire length of the three-cylinder engine is behind the front axle, you know. So if you drive the F30 318i versus any of the four-cylinder ones, right, you'll notice that the 318i has slightly sharper steering one because there's less weight hanging out at the front.
It feels more mid-engine-ish, I guess.
A bit more, yes, yes.
Then you can see from here.
So I guess it's important people to know what car they have, because I think when you drive a car, whether it's transverse or longitudinal, whether it's front wheel or rear wheel, knowing what you have makes you think about where is your tipping point, makes you know about, we spoke about last week with Ivan Kong about, you know, your balance of the car. I think it goes down to knowing what car you have, you know.
All right.
I think that's a very important topic we need to talk about, you know. What's your favorite transverse engine platform, Con? Out of curiosity.
My favorite transverse platform.
Yeah.
I would say it's a toss-up between the TNGA and the Volkswagen MQB.
Yeah.
I think truly from the dynamic standpoint, right? I think the best transverse engine platforms that I sample in recent memory, in handling wise, right, I probably give it to the TNGA, but only if it's the ones with the rear double
vision.
Double vision.
The Corolla Cross with the rear torsion beam, right? When I drive it, it's nice, but it's definitely doesn't have the fluidity of the rear double wishbone setup.
Because I guess we got to separate out that there's actually a few elements here. One element is to do with the how the engine is laid out. The other one, whether it's a rear wheel drive, because when it's rear wheel drive, you got weight in the back, and that will cause it to also give a weight distribution of the back. But I guess from the point of view of just the engine layout itself, the front, from the first front. Yeah, I think the Corolla, they're very smart, like, you know.
Correct.
Every
corner,
every inches, how to.
Very. I think the Corolla and Camry have very, very well set up suspension. It's just that, you know, I wish Toyota was a bit more adventurous with their powertrain selection. So
it's funny you mentioned the MQB platform from the Golf, and then you talk about the Corolla, the TNGA, because those two cars are cars that I feel like, wow. Drive so well, I just wish they made better interior. You know what I mean?
Hey, what's like, interior? Okay, what?
No, it's okay, but what point is it's like they try hard not to make it as good as Audi. They try very hard, you know, and the Arteon, the new one, is very nice, but I always feel that the VW always plays second fiddle. They try to make sure that the car is so good, the car is brilliant, but they're like somewhere like A.
At the end of the day, they have to make you feel justified to shout the extra 100k for an Audi
bag. This is why the Volkswagen, some Volkswagen actually, I think, fantastic value, you know.
The new Arteon, can't wait to drive it, man.
I think it's what's going to be in the post mine the next 1 year. It's funny, isn't it? Because the Arteon goes against the BMW philosophy. BMW is longitudinal, rear wheel drive, and then if you pay a lot of money, you may get four-wheel drive. But here, at a very low, seemingly low price, you get all-wheel drive, transverse, front bias.
Correct. Yes. So the rear, from what I process of the press material, right? It's a front bias all-wheel drive. Torque is sent to the rear only on demand, on an on-demand basis by a multiple plate clutch differential. So in a way, I think it's it gives you generally front wheel drive fuel economy most of the time. But it gives you all wheel drive traction when you need it most.
I think it's going to be a very easy car drive.
Car actually has the Golf R drivetrain.
I mean, if you look at the specs corner, this is once again, it was a check on DNA, what we offer on the tune is already out for the Arteon.
It's basically the same tune as you apply to a Golf R, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes. Get this. The 280 becomes 360 horsepower on stage one.
Correct.
On stage one. So 80 horsepower bump on stage one. Because and the internals...
You can catch out AMG A45s, man.
Yes, right. Yep. But the internals are very much like the Golf R, except if you look at the engine code, and I look at the engine code is a bit different. It's like J instead of C, I think. And I think what they're saying is that internals are the same, but the accessories, the ancillaries, the coolers and all that stuff, it's not the same as Golf R exactly.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, ancillaries, that one will be car to car. Yeah, one, yeah.
But the internal is very much... a Golf R, and even the gearbox, you know, that it's the 3.81 gearbox. It's you know,
and another thing that's always different on the Passat, you know, it's always the actually the transmission gear ratios. The Passat is always a lot longer.
For cruising.
Yes, it's funny how some foreign media talks about it being close to the Passat, but it's so not a Passat.
Yeah, man. In fact, for this generation, they even changed the interior. The facelift Passat that was launched here last year basically had a Passat interior and the Passat engine. But this time around, they have upgraded the engine, and they have thrown in, they have redesigned the interior as well.
Yeah.
So in a way, it better justifies the premium that you pay over the Passat.
Yeah, and also now it is actually the facelifted model as well.
All right. Because previously the pre-facelift one, you bought an Arteon because you want something to look different from a Passat, but it's still a Passat underneath. This time around, there's a bit of differentiation to justify the whole deal.
So we're going to go to the video on the longitudinal engines, and then we'll go for a break and we'll come back.
Longitudinal engines are generally used in rear-wheel drive setups. These engines are mounted down the centerline of the vehicle, forming a straight path from the crankshaft to the transmission, prop shaft, and the rear differential. For people who simply use cars as a means of getting from point A to point B, things don't really work in favor of longitudinal engines. In engineering terms, the transmission of rotational energy from the crankshaft is less efficient than a transverse engine, as a rotation has to change direction by 90 degrees via a differential to drive the wheels. Cabin space can also be hindered through the long engine effectively pushing the dashboard back, and through the transmission tunnel running down the center of the car. Then there's the fact that cars with longitudinal setups tend to be heavier, less fuel efficient, and more expensive to buy and run. But in defense of a longitudinal setup, they generally feature better turning circles and are also easier to work on thanks to less stuff in the engine bay getting in the way. The front to rear weight distribution of the car will also be preferable to a transverse orientation where mass is accumulated at the front of the chassis. This makes a car more predictable and also allows manufacturers to implement complex all-wheel drive systems using torsion differentials and viscous couplings directly down the line from the transmission. In terms of modifications, a longitudinal engine car also allows plenty of scope for engine swaps. From an inline 4 to a V6, V8 and above, the orientation of the engine block normally gives enough space for a larger power plant, and the lack of drive shafts up front adds to the simplicity in comparison to a transverse swap. The argument of transverse versus longitudinal really boils down to the application. Cars that aren't short of or don't prioritize interior space, like saloons and sports cars, can easily accommodate a longitudinal setup to take advantage of a large, powerful engine. Meanwhile, the majority of hatchbacks will go for the compact transverse option and are all the better for it. Both do their jobs extremely well. And in the world of impending EVs, long may this argument continue. Which engine layout do you prefer?
So we got a clip there on longitudinal engines. You want to hear more facts about those? Stay tuned. We're going to go for a break and we'll come back. And that's how we keep you wanting for more knowledge from CarTunes.
Touch me in the pouring rain, and the moment that you wander apart from me, I wanna feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, then you softly leave, and it's me you need to share. How deep is your love?
Welcome back, Con, from the break. We just saw something that we'll never get in Malaysia.
Yes, I know you and your thoughts now.
I have a new passion for trucks, like actually big trucks and big spaces. Yep. It's like I can't go back on like now. Nah. If they made a like your S Max in four-wheel drive and can lift, I'm like,
really? You know the day I just did a quick video, right? I said based on what's currently available, right, my dream S Max would be a diesel all-wheel drive, which right, they have in the UK actually.
Yeah.
I guess diesels are, I don't know, it's one of those things that I think that I can't go too far back, because I think if you think about year 2000 was the first time diesels came out where it was brand new, it wasn't as loud. Then as you go further, like 2010 with the what do you call it, the common rail, and then high pressures and turbos and all, like 2010 onwards, I think it was quiet enough to drive for normal.
You know, for me, the way I look at it, right, if you are talking about MPVs or SUVs, right, diesel makes more sense any time of the day.
The torque,
the effortlessness, the fuel economy.
Yeah. I mean, like my Ford Everest, it's 5 years old, 2015, but the platform engine is based on, I think, like 2010, I believe. I think it's like, so it's not a new engine. But when I'm on the highway, I'm going like at like 2 RPM, you don't hear the engine at all. It's just quite quiet. And it's quiet enough.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Your Everest is a 3 liter, right? Or a 2.5?
Yep. 3 liter.
3 liter.
I forget about it. Like 3.0. I'm just paying for the tax.
How much road tax you going to pay for it? The SUV is less.
It's less. I think it's like 1,008, somewhere there. I think it's lesser. I mean, normally, it'll be like.
Yeah. It's like a 10% discount, not a lot.
I
think it's like I have a problem, Mike. I don't remember my own taxes. I just pay them. So I really think about it.
Because good, it doesn't bank in the pocket quite as much as you forget.
All I know is my road tax expired and I haven't paid because it's MCO. So I'm happy.
Might as well actually. I mean, you basically just remember to start your car and drive it around your taman every once in a while.
But also remember, please guys, make sure you have your insurance available, because even if there's no road tax, the car can get stolen, car can have accident, or just taman alone.
Yeah.
The car was insured, and if you know about Evo Club Insurance, you got a great deal on your insurance. You can save up to 40% or more. It's what I use and Con use, and a lot of us in the club use. Driving, we don't pay for it. All right. Head over to Evo Club Insurance and save money. It's a shameless plug there, sorry.
Thanks, Pana.
No problem.
So I guess we've got a question about all-wheel drive engine. Yeah. I guess the what we spoke earlier was that all-wheel drive engine could have engine both ways, could be transverse.
Yes, it could work both ways. So you remember the age-old rivalry of the Evo versus the WRX?
Mm.
Both are all-wheel drive, but one is transverse engine, the other is longitudinal engine.
Longitudinal, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So you can all-wheel drive, doesn't matter one whether you are transverse or longitudinal. Yep. Both can be done.
It's just the engineering behind it. Like you can engineer your way around everything.
Correct.
Correct.
I mean, just like the 911s as well. You can have four-wheel drive, rear engine. Yeah.
Correct.
And then you four-wheel drive. You have.
Correct. Correct.
Mm. Yes.
You got a question about crumpled zone and engine type. So you mentioned this earlier. We can brief it a bit more, Con.
Well, this is something that I think we sort of addressed earlier on. If you are front end, this is something from Volvo. So I guess these guys know their stuff, it was mentioned earlier in the video. Volvo abandoned longitudinal engine for configuration for their cars because they feel they can engineer the front crumple zones better with transverse engine. Because the transverse engine, when you put it in front of you transversely, right, if you have a frontal collision, the engine block itself in a way acts as a shield, right, to help absorb part of the collision energy. But when your engine is longitudinal, there certain circumstances the engine can be pushed into the cabin.
I guess it's like if you think about when you're playing bottle caps when we're young. So maybe some listeners don't understand. So you hit the bottle cap, one hit other and other. There's a after.
Oh, that game dates back that long. I played that too in my school days.
Bro, we are about the same age group, lah. Okay. So we learn about a transfer of energy. So if you have the engine as a transverse, more likely there's more things in the front of the car. Things like your cooling units and all that stuff is there. When it's a longitudinal engine, it's a lesser thing. So it's a bit more thinner, lesser space to be there. And sometimes what you call, if you're seeing a car that are transverse, kosong in front there, but the kosongness is what helps you to absorb the impact on
the Correct.
Yep.
So it's safer, and
when it comes to safety and crumple zones, nobody knows their shit better than Volvo. So if Volvo says that's true, they definitely have a point there.
But that doesn't mean that BMW isn't safe, because they also have a different way of addressing the same issue. It's how you address it. You address it by having crumple zones like Proton, which crumple, or you can have a different way of by the engine dislocates and go under the car itself.
Correct.
There's a lot of ways.
Correct. You see, the thing is that, right, Volvo is all, this is also partly brand narrative. You see, Volvo, their brand narrative is always safety and environmental sustainability. So for them, right, it's perfectly legit to sacrifice any aspect of their car design. They just throw word safety up. You cannot say anything really, it's safety. But whereas BMW has invested so much of its marketing talk on, you know, their 50-50 weight distribution, on, you know, rear wheel front engine, rear wheel drive and all that, even though now they have introduced the transverse engine setup for their lower models, they still need to persevere with the longitudinal engine configuration, partly mainly because it's an integral component of their brand narrative.
I read somewhere when the Audi wanted to make the A4 to be a MQB platform. They want to share the platform with the Golf and the Passat over to the A4. And they said they will save $1 billion over the lifetime of the A4 generation. $1 million. But they said, no lah. Because they do that, they lose what is Audi, they lose that whole long nose.
Right. And it's interesting that you brought up the A4, because Audi has a very unique way of laying out their front wheel drive cars. Audi, I can think, you guys in the comment section, correct me if I'm wrong, is the only car maker that I know of that lays their engine longitudinal and do front wheel drive. Like your O8, your A6 hybrid, for example.
A6 is longitudinal.
But it's
front wheel drive, because it's just missing the rear, because it's missing the auto component. So it's more auto cutting tool, you know?
So, Micah, there was this image that I shared that day from the from an official Audi image one of the way they, it's one of their old images, like, if you wouldn't mind bringing that up.
Hang on, just let me. Yeah. Okay, I got it. Hang on. This one.
So you see, this is how Audi lays out their front wheel drive. Now this is a graphic that illustrates Audi's old safety feature called Procon 10, which is Audi's answer to not having airbags at that time. In the event of a collision, the engine gets pushed back, and all these cables, right, will pull the steering wheel toward the dashboard, and thus spare you your head from hitting the steering wheel, which would definitely mean, from a cost perspective, if you cannot, your car will be total loss, don't have to fix really one. Notice how the engine sits fully in front of the front axle, then the gearbox, and then there are two drive shafts that come out from the side of the gearbox. So Audi is, to my mind, to my knowledge, the only car maker that lays out their engine for front wheel drive configuration like that. And the advantage of this actually is you eliminate torque steer.
Yep.
Yep.
You got left and right side the same one.
Yep. Correct.
Definitely, the Audi front wheel drive handles differently than compared to
front heavy. It's about I would say it's about getting used to the characteristics of the car.
Yes.
We got a clip from Korn here. I wanted to share.
Oh,
it's a bit unique, okay? Because Audi alternates between front and all wheel drive, but despite the front wheel drive layout being predominantly associated with transverse engines, Audi utilizes a longitudinal engine to power its front wheel drive models as well. Okay, A4 upwards, the A3 models and below utilize Volkswagen group Volkswagen platforms. So those are transverse engines as well. Now, Audi's solution is a bit of an oddball. Okay, so that is why Audis have a bit of a nose heavy feel, because they because of their insistence on having a long engine, a longitudinally mounted engine and front wheel drive. What actually happens is that here's the front axle. Audi's engines are mounted ahead of the front axle. So it means that when you drive in an Audi, right, there's always an additional weight hanging over the front wheels, and that is why Audis inherently feel nose heavy.
So yeah, so if guys, if you want to hear more of Korn's videos, head over to youtube.com/KornWailuen. That's KONWAILUEN. A lot of Korn's videos are very interesting because he goes to details about these things, which makes you rethink about cars and how they're engineered and appreciate them. Because if a car ownership is purely about buying a car and you have it, it's no fun. Car ownership is about knowing your car, why was it in such a certain way. You know the knowledge, you're like, I appreciate
my car. And now that with this MCO dragging on forever, right, I have plenty of time to come up with more such videos. That's my backlog.
Yeah.
I always love your Millennium Falcon, actually. You should do a video about the Millennium Falcon.
I don't have a Millennium Falcon yet.
Or Star Wars, is it? Something, no, I remember seeing.
And you know, Colin, both Isaac and Brian loves your videos.
Oh, thank you.
All the exact details that you go through, you know.
Thank you. I shall endeavor to produce more.
Yes.
So before the break, we spoke about the original engines and the video on CarTUNES about how the design was. It makes sure the cabin space are smaller, and also about the tunnel. So if you imagine all your cars, the BMWs and Audis had the tunnel there, that's because they had to design the car to have a rear wheel drive, and they have a drive shaft, a shaft going the rear. What's your thought, Colin? I think as we now we go to a point whereby more and more cars are focusing on cheap to build. That means they're becoming transverse. Certain manufacturers are still holding on to the whole power of that rear wheel drive feel to it. Where do you think the future will be for mass produced cars? I mean, forget the BMWs and the Audis, but mass produced cars.
Will be electric, bro.
Okay. I think also,
electric. The motor just put at the corner of the car, and that's it. Done already.
But how many motors you think there would be?
It's either two or four. But actually, right, it's not quite true to say that longitudinal engine rear wheel drive cars will be exclusive for high end cars. Because there is another application for longitudinal engine rear wheel drive. It's for heavy vehicles or when you need to carry heavy load, high payloads.
Yeah.
Toyota Avanza is this. Toyota Rush, Pro Duo Arus, your pickup trucks, your Everest. These are not what we call your luxury cars, but they persevere with the front engine rear wheel drive configuration because because they think that this is much better balanced if your vehicle will need to alternate between just the driver alone and suddenly carrying heavy load.
Yeah, I think people forget also that from a point of view of mechanical volume and massness, a truck is actually way costlier than cars overseas. Only in Malaysia it is cheap. You know, so all these cars are actually expensive cars, and that's why
they're
cost to produce.
In fact, actually, your Hilux and your Ranger and all that, cost as much as a Golf, in those countries or more.
Is it like the the Avanza and the Rush are the only cars in are the only seven seaters in that price segment that are still rear view drive, and Toyota is persisting with it because to Toyota that gives, and the Innova, actually Innova, so their rear view drive setup, right, allows their car, allows their car to carry big payloads better. Right, because when you carry big payloads, right, the weight will sit on the rear, and the rear will have better traction.
I mean, these are cars designed for Southeast Asia, but specifically, these are cars designed for the places whereby like Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand. They need to carry Philippines. They need to carry. It's a multi-purpose vehicle in that sense. Yeah. Do a lot of things. Yeah. Carry for work and stuff. At the same time, cheap enough to make. They can't give you. They can't give you a four-wheel drive. But the two-wheel drive rear wheel drive gives you that kind of almost feeling of grip. And,
but of course, for mid-range, for entry-level to mid-range cars, it's definitely transverse engine front-wheel drive one. This has been the trend for the last 30, 40 years. It's still going to be, right?
All this started from the Mini, I think more than 50 years ago.
And I think the inflection point probably was the 70s and the 80s, where before that, your Datsun 120i, your Toyota Corolla, before they were all rear view drive. And in the 80s, one by one, they went front wheel drive.
Correct. The first one was Honda Civic, actually, among the Japanese manufacturers.
Honda Civic was straight out front wheel drive already, right? First gen.
First gen.
Is there a Honda with a rear wheel drive? So that's all wheel drive, I guess.
Of course, the S2000. What else? Honda.
I can't recall the top of my head, but sure got one.
Performance car, I know.
Yeah.
S2000, very quickly, S2K. S2000. It's a unicorn.
Now, quarter of a million already. Crazy.
And going up.
Yes.
And going up.
Yep.
So, I mean, it's something that I guess in the future we're going electric. It'll be either two-wheel drive or four-wheel drive. If it's a two-wheel drive, most likely it will be a rear-wheel drive. Correct. It'll be a rear wheel drive electric or front wheel drive electric. What's your guess?
It depends, you know, actually, because the thing is that, right, if you mount your electric motors at the rear, you will need to watch out for boot space.
I think what happened is, because I think from what I've seen so far, because the batteries can't be in the front. On collision, the battery can't be in the front, the batteries are always in the center or the rear.
Batteries have to be within the wheelbase of the car.
Wheelbase or sometimes also in the rear, and for that reason, I think it's a flip. Like if I was designing, I'll probably put it in the front because it will feel more like a normal car. The weight in the back for the batteries, the front will be the engine. But you're right, like it's a swing, it's a flip. Porsche Taycan, for example.
Because once you go electric, right, it's a totally different ball game already. The mechanical complexity of the car is significantly reduced.
But the same complexity and the same thought about the idea of being transverse longitudinal still carries on, because we still think about on impact, where does it go to? And that's why the battery, for example, isn't placed in front, because of impact.
Correct.
How does it go to the car chassis? The whole thought about the weight is still an issue. And I guess now with what we learn from engines that are transverse, having block steer, that's why we said maybe it's better not to have one motor and shared. Maybe it's better to have the two motors on the sides. Cheaper to drill, better to maintain the cooling.
And the challenge there would be to write the the control software codes to ensure that the two motors operate in unison in their response to your throttle inputs.
And that's not easy.
And the traction control as well.
It's like I think trying to say, like, because wear and tear is different on each engine.
Correct.
And as they even if they're brushless motor, but wear and tear is different. How do you regulate that? Same as you having like a W12 engine, how do you regulate two banks at the same time, you know?
Yeah.
Same concept is there.
Jim, might I have a question for you?
Yeah.
You see, for the whole this whole discussion debate about longitudinal engine versus transverse engine. Now I can see how it impacts chassis tuning, suspension setup. But does it impact the engine tuning?
It does. It does.
How?
In a way, because how the power is being delivered. Because when you are front wheel drive, right? Let's say you can have 320 horses. So how if we give you all the 320 horses, you know, on the lower gears, you're gonna speed. You're gonna spin your wheels.
All right.
You know, I think last week Ivan did say something like, you know, one wheel maybe you can handle about 120 horses, and that's about it. So you know, you can have a very powerful GTI, maybe 300 horses or 320 horses. But the magic is, and the tuning is, you know, how you're going to lay the power down without spinning it, spinning it off, you know, in your first couple of gears, you know, especially the first 3 to 4 gears. Because that's these cars nowadays, they are picking, what, 400 plus Newton meters of torque easily.
The
2 liter engine, easily.
Actually you, once you've got the upper end, once you hit the upper end of 200 Newton meters, right, it's very easy to wheel spin ready.
Correct. So it's about laying that power down onto the tarmac rather than software again.
I guess for those people who are wondering why will that impact, because when an engine isn't fixed solid to a chassis, it's on an engine mount. As and when the engine spins, there is movement, and that movement can stop and spin and all that. So the way the engine moves, whether it moves this way or this way,
how the twist of the engine. And also, you know, how linear your throttle is, that's very important, because you know, I think Con, you test a lot of car, you know, two cars can have 200 horses, you know, maybe 350 Newton meters of torque, but how the power is being delivered is could be very different. So one question for you, Con, you know, in the maybe we got to go 18 months because of all this lockdown, and maybe you have not tested so many cars. Now, which car which you have tested, you know, actually disappointed you the most?
Disappointed?
That means you saw the spec, this one got 300 horses, you know, then you expect something out of it, you know, but once you drove it,
let me help you rephrase the question. Which car, because I think all cars, I think it's hard to con to put on a car, but all cars, I think, have got a certain place on what they deliver, you know, and the whole media and the whole the hype for it tell you a certain thing. And when you get to it, you're like, oh, this car's okay, but it isn't for what I thought it was. And I'll start from mine. Yeah. For me, it was the Volvo S60. Because before it came out, it was like, oh, this is going to be a monster of a car. So much of torque, you know, it's crazy, it's powerful, you know? And we had a muscle car hype about it almost. The power was so crazy. When you drove it, I was like, oh, I like this car. But not because it was all crazy, you know? It was all refined, so nice, so nice to drive, you know? It was a letdown in one sense, but I love the car for different things altogether and in a different way. So I think that's the way of kind of, because all cars is quite fun. Like even Axia has got its place.
Yeah.
We have its place, you know, all cars got their place. Which car kind of like you think like, whoa, I didn't think this war. It's different, huh?
Actually the car that comes to mind is the 2 Series Grand Coupe. I drove the car, I was like, it gave me the feeling that it's the car has unfinished business. It doesn't feel, and the thing is that, right? It doesn't, it's, you see, the thing is that, right? It's not about the car being front wheel drive or not. Because BMW Group has had great success with Mini. So front wheel drive know-how is well embedded into the BMW brand. But when I drove the 2 Series Grand Coupe, I just felt that the car isn't quite as well tuned as I think a car in that price range should be.
I think I don't know about you guys, but I think it's more of it's different.
Yeah.
And I think people have, I think your point you're trying to say is that you is different because you're so used to BMW to be this expectation.
Oh, yeah.
You come there, it's, oh, I didn't expect this. I didn't expect it to be like this. It's not bad or good because my wife drove the car, like, it feels like any other Japanese car. That's what she said. And I said, oh, because, and I'm like, oh, because this, and you're like, oh, okay, lah. But yeah, the car looks nice. But, you know, yeah, the expectation and the reality doesn't jive against that.
Yeah.
I think it depends whether you come from an enthusiast viewpoint or
absolutely
it's a transport. Yeah, I think if no, there's a transport, I mean, I've been your first in this, BMW is fine, I think.
I've been in this line long enough to be able to calibrate my expectations according to the to the target demographic. So when I first drove the X1, the front wheel drive X1, I was like thinking, oh, okay, this is a car that traditional BMW owners, they come to this, they'll find this car weird. But people who have never experienced a BMW, they come, they go to this, they say, hey, this is a good entry point into the BMW brand, and that car serves its purpose.
Yep. Mm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that the GC somehow, it, I feel it missed that final tenths of tuning.
Yeah. I almost feel that they could have made it. They can't. I almost feel like they can't catch up in mechanical prowess. They can't. So they tried a lot of doing the colors, the lights, the paint. They tried all those bits here and there.
Because styling wise, the 2GC was one of the cars that caught my wife's attention when I brought it home. So that car was there onto something with regards to the way the car is packaged, the way the car is styled. So I think for that car, right, I think and the thing is that the 1.5 liter B38 engine, I have no hatred for that engine. I drove that engine in the 3 series and I thought in the F33 series, hey, this is nice, right? It's it's a bit down on power, right? But it's nice. It's nice. Then I drove it, like somehow it doesn't feel quite so resolved.
So that final bit of refinement
that you expect from
BMW, I guess.
Because when I drove the car, the thought that came to my mind is, I think it's better you just spend the extra 20,000 and get the 320i.
I think from a BM fanboy, I think you're like, I want the soul of BM. I want it to be there. I want the BMW.
I mean, Con, since you have driven the X1 as well, I'm sure you have driven the Countryman as well, right?
The Countryman,
yes. So how different does it feel? Because both of it are using the same platform, actually.
Ah, good question. Somehow when with Mini, right, they always manage to give it a little more zing in the car's character.
Yes.
So with a Mini, right, you don't even need to drive. You just look at the car, you sit in the car, you're like all smiles already.
Correct.
Mini has that effect.
Yeah.
And even though Mini is a greater Meiwa, is a luxury car, right? But it is also in a way a car that transcends class. Right? If you are a super rich, right, you are somebody who was playing in Bugatti in Bentley level, you don't mind coming down to a Mini because it's still it projects a different
it's an iconic car, you know.
And the best part with Mini is that the appeal of Mini also transcends demographics. You can be a poser, you can be a hardcore enthusiast, right. There is a Mini for you.
Yes.
And also the Countryman sits a bit lower, isn't it, Con?
I think so, yes.
The Countryman is a bit lower and the X1 is a bit taller, and the X1 interior is crap, sorry to say. And the Countryman is so nice.
Yeah.
It's my personal feelings. Like, I find the X1, the price point is like, I like the 2GC, it's nice. The 2GC interior, I think, is I'm happy with the interior. I love the way it looks. I think a car for my wife would drive. My wife loves the way it looks. I don't mind buying it for her, but I share with you, I think that, like something more, I want something more.
Yeah.
I mean, when you jump into the Mini, right, the thing is, you know, the car is nicely honed for what it is.
correct.
You know, there's
correct.
No mistake about it, you know, when you jump into
correct. And that's a good point. Nicely yes. honed.
Yes.
You right. We can feel it when, you know, when we get yes. into the car, we sit in there, right? Yes. You know, yes. you can feel whether the manufacturer has spent that final tenth yep. of effort correct. To fine-tune the car. So
yes.
So I'll give you a good example. Mazda is one example of a manufacturer that you sit in, you drive, you know yep. the manufacturer has spent every effort polishing every damn screw to make yep. sure every component in there works in perfect unison.
Yes.
So Mike, I got a question for you. So Con is a BMW fanboy and he just put on a BMW. You are a VW guy through and through. So yeah. what VW have you driven? And you're like, that moment came to you. And I'll do my Audi, okay? I'll be fair. Okay. Okay? I'll do my Audi. Okay. So for you, for your VW, which VW you went to, like, yeah, why?
I think for me, it has to be the Beetle.
Oh.
Okay.
Has to be the Beetle. I mean, the car is such an iconic car, you know, and you know, VW can make GTIs, you know, the car is fun to drive, Polo GTIs, you know, all those are fun to drive, but why not a Beetle?
You see, the Beetle was a Mark 7 era product with a Mark 6 platform.
Correct.
And the thing is that I don't understand is why did they down-spec the 1.2 and the 1.4 with a torsion beam rear axle?
Correct. You know, why? Yeah. And why didn't they use the MQB platform? Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
I tell you, we go from the Mark 6 platform to the MQB platform. The upgrade is big. You know, every time I drive a car with the MQB platform, doesn't matter if Volkswagen or Audi, right? Yep. That platform has that feel of refinement to it, you know.
Yes. And you know, the way the car rides.
Refinement to it, you know.
Correct.
Right. And that, you know, all your inputs, your steering inputs, your throttle inputs, your brake inputs is all very finely honed, very finely calibrated. Because one thing you know, before MQB platform, right, Volkswagens didn't have brake pedals, they have brake switches.
Correct. Very it's much like so.
You get full braking or no braking.
Yes. The brake modulation was bad. And then also the throttle, you know, when you touch the throttle, and when you are at 60-70% throttle, and when you full throttle, there's not much to it. It's not so linear, the throttle, on the earlier cars. You know, the MQB cars are much more linear. You know,
And then the braking is a lot better. In fact, right, I think for Audis, right, the MQB cars drive better than the A4, A5 upwards.
Definitely.
I think if you don't go for Quattro, you're right. It's the A3 would be
and good. And also the turn in of the cars, you know, with the XDS with the XDS in it, you know, it's just the electronic differential is just beautiful. And I was sharing with Con, right? You know, I'm on the XDS, you know, we can play with the coatings, right? You know, so if you put it more aggressive, right? You know, the car actually pulls through the corner with very little understeer, but a bit unnerving.
Are you able to trigger it to the point of oversteer or not?
No lah, it doesn't do that lah. But it's very aggressive the way it turns in. But to a but to a point where it feels artificial lah. Con has gone to get his baby.
So I mean, if I were to share mine, would be the A5.
And the A5.
The A5 for me, Con was saying, the A5, the front wheel drive A5, to me was a little more of a letdown. I just felt that they could have done more. They have done more with the A5 front-wheel drive version of it. It just didn't feel sorted, you know. It was just, it felt very much front-heavy. It very much felt it was diving a little bit, you know. I just felt that there wasn't enough weight in the rear to make it complete. So that's one of the cars that you look at it like, wow, it's so beautiful. Get the car, So I think, but the Audi is you can always buy Quattro. If you buy Quattro, then you're safe, you know.
For me, all the MLB platform out this, right? A4 upwards are definitely go Quattro, man. No question.
You must buy Quattro with all the MLB platforms.
You know, a few years ago, I was reviewing the A6, the same generation of yours, but the 1.8.
Mm. Yeah.
So I was on Karak Highway, you know, Mercedes W212 E-Class. I came up to the car, straight line, I keep up, no problem. But once there's a bend, right, I'm like, shit, I see the fella pulling ahead of me already.
1.8 is a CVT, right?
No, because it's the facelift, right? At that time, facelift Audi dropped the CVT already. Pre-facelift 2-liter had the CVT.
So it was really, really low spec.
Yeah. Hey, but you know, at that time, remember at that time, the A6 1.8, right? The car was CBU, but they managed to get the thing's pricing below the Mercedes BlueTEC hybrid, you know?
Oh, okay.
Wow.
Yeah. I was like, wow, this car CBU and it's cheaper than the BlueTEC hybrid.
But no sunroof, no dynamic lights.
Kosong
Very kosong. The sound system is very kosong. I got my friends who are driving the car. It's very, very empty.
Yeah, very kosong.
Okay, so we're coming to
engine efficiency, I think, that one.
Yeah. So we come above our 1 hour mark. Thank you, Korn, for joining us. It was a fun and educational session.
Yep.
I hope you guys learn about original versus transverse engine. The idea behind this session is obviously to educate you to know what you can do about tuning potentials. I think today's takeaway was the fact that even if you could tune an engine, knowing what type of engine there is, it's important to tune the car, because if not, the car could throw off balance when you go to a corner.
All right.
In the first gear, for example.
The way the engine is mounted and where it's mounted, it definitely affects the balance of the car. And because remember, the engine is the heaviest component of your car.
Yes. Even engine mountings play a part.
Correct.
Okay, guys. We'll see you next week at 4 o'clock, same time, on a Sunday. Have fun, stay safe, and stay positive, but COVID negative.
Yeah.
All right.